here. For Karen, Frank, and Lori and their boys, Doug and Deanna and the girls, and for Lars and Mark and Carola, seeing you in the room is very, very significant and quite special. It's in the context of community, and it's in the presence of God that we acknowledge the life of Erwin Wall, a husband, a father, a grandfather, a brother, a friend to many across the globe, and a dear friend to our church community. Although there is sadness this morning, we have come to celebrate the life of a man who was a builder, an innovator, a rancher, a visionary, a man who embraced life to the fullest. We also come this morning to celebrate a man who understood and was completely convicted that he was a child of God, that he was a follower of Jesus Christ, that he was called to be a faithful servant, had a generous spirit, the gift of hospitality, and was passionate about building God's kingdom here on earth. And so we celebrate his faithfulness to God, and we celebrate God's faithfulness to him. For certain, Erwin's heart this morning is that for each of us, we would find our strength and our hope in God, a God that he trusted completely. And so I invite each of you to anchor this celebration in the person of Jesus. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Jesus also said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." And then the words from the Apostle Peter. "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, never spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you." Let's bow our heads and pray together. Father God, we come before you and we recognize that you are our refuge, our strength, and our comforter. You are always willing to hear us when we pray. Even in our pain and our sadness, you know our needs. And so we count on your strength and your grace this morning to overcome our sorrow. Open our hearts and our minds to your leading as we celebrate the life of Erwin Wall and his new eternity with you. Thank you for the gift of Jesus who conquered death in order to make a way for each of us. And may we experience in powerful ways the joy that comes with an eternity rooted in you. And may our celebration inspire all of us to lead our lives completely committed to you. In the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen. You know, if you know Erwin well, you know that this man had a very strong passion for music, for a full band on Sunday morning, for a great deal of energy from the stage. And so we've selected some songs this morning that really ring true with his heart for music. And the first one is Cornerstone, and the lyrics go like this, and I think it anchors our service this morning. The words go, "My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name." I invite you to stand, join the band as we sing a couple of songs together.
Let's worship together the God that Erwin loved so deeply and served so, so well.
Thank you. Thank you. Erwin's brother, together with my wife, Anita, and also Doris, Karen's sister, and her husband, Theo. We have come from Paraguay to bring greetings and to be with you in this in these moments and these days of saying goodbye to Erwin. So I am honored to bring some words of greetings from the extended family, and so I would like first to start with the side of Karen's extended family, which has like this. Dear Karen, dear nephews and children, Erwin, our brother-in-law, had become a very good friend to us. He was an excellent Christian. Through our relationship with him, we have learned about things in life which otherwise would have remained undiscovered for us. He and Karen visited us every year in Paraguay for a couple of weeks. So together we spent many wonderful hours talking, discussing about our families, our projects, about life, and about God. These special moments we will miss a lot. Dear Karen, the fall of life has come into your life way too early. We suffer with you, but just as well, we know that Erwin is in good hands with God, his Father. Isaiah 43, verse 1 says, do not be afraid, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. Mutti, Doris und Theodor Neufeld, Tamara und Baran Thompson. From Erwin's extended family, dear Karen, dear nephews and children, as extended ball family from Paraguay, from Germany and Canada, we want to offer our sincere condolences to you. We share the pain of saying goodbye to a much loved person. Erwin, your husband, your dad, our brother and uncle. Erwin's solid faith in Christ and his firm convictions always had an impact on all of us. He loved his family so much, and he cared as well about his extended family, and especially about Vientos de Esperanza, the home for girls with special needs in Asunción. He loved those girls so much that he took them out to McDonald's every time he came to Paraguay, even though the last time they totaled about 65 already. We say goodbye to Erwin and would like to encourage you, dear Karen family, with the words of Jesus he said at the grave of his dear friend. I am the resurrection and life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. Elvira from Germany, Regina and Hardy, Ilona and David, Melita, Elda, Adelina and David, Victor and Margita, with their families.
Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
I'll be reading from John 14, verses 1 to 3. Jesus said to his disciples, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be.
Unfortunately, Doug is sick this morning. He's feeling a little sick. My name is Lars, and this is my brother Mark. We are two of Erwin's sons, and we'll be reading Dad's life story instead. Anyone who has met our dad, even briefly, will know that he is a man happy to share his opinions freely. Or for him, these opinions are more like universal truths. One opinion he's brought up is that he doesn't appreciate it when eulogies make a person sound too perfect or embellish a person's character. Of course, it's unclear whether he wanted to apply this to his own funeral life story, but to honor his values, we will try. Dad was born on September 1st, 1950, in a small village in dry and harsh Chaco of Paraguay. Like many Mennonites, his grandparents had settled in Paraguay after leaving Russia as refugees. His parents were Peter and Lise Wall. He had six sisters and one brother. Even from a young age, Dad was an innovator. Our Uncle Victor tells a story about when Dad attempted to build his own hunting rifle. Apparently, he was lucky to survive. Another time, he was working on an experimental farm still in Paraguay, use the mechanics of a clock to control the generator in order to make the work easier. His sister talked of him sitting in a hammock, inventing ways to accomplish his chores more efficiently. Dad always said problems were there to be solved. Growing up, Dad dreamed of running a ranch in Paraguay. However, he was selected for a one-year foreign aid bursary from the German government to observe the water system in the town of Zost. To his surprise, this led to his acceptance into the civil engineering program at the University of Zeta. Dad's dream of owning and running a ranch in Paraguay would have to wait. Anyone who knows Dad knows he is stubborn. It is perhaps this stubbornness that got him through university. He often told us kids how difficult school had been for him and how he had to redo almost every exam. It is also perhaps this persistence that swayed Mom, Karen Cleaver. Somehow, in a single visit to Paraguay, he met and convinced Mom to move to Germany. More likely, this was love at first sight, as the two married on January 4th, 1975. He then graduated from university and worked for an engineering firm. Missing the freedom and possibilities of a country less populated and less regulated than Germany, he, Karen, and one-year-old Frank immigrated to Canada in 1977. He never regretted this move. Hard work was always very important to Dad, and he demonstrated this in his own life again and again. It was not an easy start during those early years in St. Catharines. Dad would work various construction jobs during the day, take English classes at night, all the while trying to acclimatize to Canada's cold winters. Mom and Dad had three more children during these years, Deanna, Lars, and Mark. Dad loved his family deeply, even though at this stage in his life, he struggled with how to express his love. Lars remembers early morning board games played with Dad before he left for work. This could be why Lars still got a thrill when beating Dad in Settlers, even recently. Mark remembers Dad coming to many of his sports games, so proud of him being out there. Mom remembers having matzo with Dad every morning and debriefing the day over tete-a-tete in the afternoon. Frank thinks of going camping with Dad at Bissell's Hathaway. Deanna remembers a time playing chess with Dad. In a frustrated voice, he said to her, "Deanna, we don't play to have fun, we play to win." This competitive edge in Dad, as well as his amazing gift in innovation, might have been what led to him to start Trek Shunner Roads in 1994 at the age of 44. He began with a single machine and two employees, slowly and steadily growing the company to what it is today. From the outset, his vision was for a company that not only benefited himself and his family, but also his employees and his community. Dad was a generous man. This past summer, he said to Deanna, "Sometimes people tell me that anything I touch turns turns to gold. But the truth is, I know that God has blessed me so that I can bless others. Even before Dad had a successful business, there is often someone in need of a place to stay, living with our family. He gave generously to the church and to organizations in Paraguay and Africa. Even in these last months, having seen pictures of barefoot children in Burundi, Dad began dreaming of a sustainable solution that would provide both shoes and jobs. It wasn't until Dad's latter years that he both softened and learned how to relax. Well, maybe not relax, but he no longer needed to focus so much of his efforts on the business as Frank became more and more involved. He still had much advice for us children, whether it was to have children, to get married, to spend more time together, or just not to move to Africa. But indeed, some of his rough edges rounded. While his listening skills may not have improved during this time in his life, other things had. He made sure to say, "I love you," more often, go out for more coffees with friends, go on hunting and fishing trips with his friends. Read action novels, sit by a fire with his family as often as we would let him, visit us children around the world, continued to grow in generosity, and strangely, really got into the CFL. Finally fulfilled his lifelong dream of owning a ranch in Paraguay named Paso Blanco. He really felt this was a gift from God. Part of his life's joy became working on this ranch for 2 months of the year. In his last 3 years, he downsized into his retirement home. He built it with the hope to be self-sufficient and to live off the land, including the plan to have enough chickens and cows to supply all his kids with, of course, meat. He built it big enough for all his kids and grandkids to come home, and continued his open-door policy, never locking any of the doors. Perhaps the one trait that defined Dad most was a man striving to follow Jesus and who put his hope in the kingdom of God. As children and later as adults, we saw our dad and mom sit together every morning, drinking mate, talking, reading the Bible, and praying. After a few weeks of headaches and increased tiredness, doctors discovered Dad had a brain tumor. Due to complications and the aggressiveness of the tumor, Dad spent his final days in hospice. As a family, we desperately hoped that Dad would have a few good months of life, but it wasn't to be. 30 days after diagnosis, Dad passed away. During those 30 days, it became apparent just how many people Dad's life had touched. He received many, many visitors, notes of encouragement, gifts, and phone calls. He was deeply impacted by this and said that the prayers and support of everyone are what carried him. He was so touched that people cared for him. His strong and stubborn character also shone through at this time, as he rarely accepted advice or direct orders from nurses or doctors, even attempting to bribe his way out of the hospital. His care and concern for the family and for friends was also abundantly clear till the end. As soon as he found out his diagnosis, while still in the hospital, he was texting his accountant, his lawyer, his plumber, wanting to make sure everything was in order, the house, the finances, and the business. Initially, as the reality of the situation came to bear, he wondered aloud about Jesus' love and his grace, reflecting on his past. These were very intimate moments of a man facing the end of his life, and we as a family felt privileged to be part of it. As it became clear that he had very little time left, his resolve and faith also became more clear. Dad was not a perfect man, but Jesus was the center of his life. I'd like to conclude with something Dad said when he was first diagnosed. "Well, Karen, I didn't really want to die yet, but boy, did we have a good life." Thank
you. Well, thanks a lot for sharing that, guys. We really appreciate that. My name's Jeff Lockyer. I'm the lead pastor here at Southridge, and it's a privilege to be able to share a few words to him on behalf of the family. Rick introduced this time together, calling it a celebration. And I guess my question for all of us here today is, how do you get there? How do you get to a place where you can feel in your heart like celebrating? One of the most innovative minds most of us will ever know all of a sudden gets riddled with brain cancer. A husband, a dad, a grandparent, a friend, and an employer all of a sudden gets their life cut short. And an investor in so many initiatives around the community and even across the globe doesn't get to make those investments anymore. People that I've talked to since Erwin's diagnosis and as his health faded would react with shock and sorrow and just devastation. I don't know about you, but I didn't come across any celebration. Even as I've reflected on it personally, Erwin and I were good friends, and you know, I can't help but think about what his life could have been like if he even absorbed a little bit of the gear of retirement. Do you think he would have been able to do that at all, Karen? I sometimes wonder how that travel bug might have caught him and them together. You know, I think about you guys and all of the weddings and the graduations and the birthday parties that he won't be around to enjoy with all of you. I think about the missions and the ministries that he cared so deeply about all around the world, never getting to really experience the full potential, the full fruit of all of the investments, you know, not just in financial resources, but in his passion and care. And I look around thinking, like, where's the celebration in all of that? How do you get in a moment like this to the place where you can sincerely celebrate? So what I want us to do for just a few moments is focus on what may feel like a very odd passage in the Bible for what to me is a very odd time and a very odd circumstance where we find ourselves so deeply saddened and so gripped with loss, yet trying to live out that sense and value of celebration. It's a passage written in the New Testament of the Bible. It's actually a letter or a portion of a letter written by a guy we call the Apostle Paul, who was writing to a church in a place called Philippi. And in this letter, he writes about all kinds of specifics and issues that the church was facing. But he takes some moments in this section to just kind of reflect on his own life. Brad, if you can throw it up on the screen there. I'll read it a couple times. He says here about himself, "To me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I'm able to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet, what shall I choose? I do not know. I'm torn between the two, because I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body." And keep it up there for a moment, Brad. I'll just reflect on it. Paul is talking about his life, first of all, his life on earth, and I think in a lot of ways, just like Erwin, he had a lot to be grateful for. He talks about a life of fruitful labor, a life of significance, of purpose, of difference-making in the lives of others. Paul was the kind of guy who enjoyed getting out of bed in the morning because he knew he had reason to. You know, he lived in this relationship with other people that was joyous and heartfelt. He experienced community and family, not just with this, you know, extended spiritual family, but with many others. And in a lot of ways, this fruitful labor kind of defined the life on earth of the Apostle Paul. It was the kind of life that you and I would envy to have. And yet in reflecting on his earthly life compared to what would happen if that was over, he says he's actually kind of torn. That he's not sure which he would choose, because previously in this letter and in others, he's alluded to the reality that Paul has chosen to live as a follower of Jesus. And as a follower of Jesus, forgiven and set free through his death, and empowered through the risen life of Jesus, he says now his life is defined by the presence and activity of Jesus in and through him. That's what he means when he says, for me to live is Christ. Now his life is simply lived in the power and for the purposes of the Jesus within him. And because of that, he says he's kind of torn with what he would rather choose, because his top priority was his relationship with Jesus, and he knew that if his earthly life were to end, he would be able to experience that in all its fullness. There'd be no chasm of invisibility and kind of intangibility. He'd be able to experience Jesus face to face for all eternity, which is why he gets to the place where he says, you know, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. He says it's gain because he would get to be with Christ, he says, which is better by far. And you can kind of see his value system live out. But what's interesting is that he makes a comment, though, about the loss were his earthly life to end. And he alludes not to himself, he alludes to all of the people around him. All of the people who were affected by the life of Jesus within him. He says, I appreciate that if my life were to end, I would gain, it would be everyone else. He doesn't say this arrogantly, he's just saying it matter-of-factly. It would be everyone else who would suffer the loss because of the lack of experience of the Jesus within and through me. And he recognizes that what might be his gain would be other people's. Do you see the two perspectives that Paul is surfacing here? The perspective of the people around him who would feel a sense of sorrow and sadness and loss because of his absence, but a true sense of joy and fulfillment and thrill for him to be in the presence of Jesus if his life were to end. Because for him to live was Christ and to die was only gain. It was better by far for him if his life on earth was to end. Yes, the fruitful labor would end, and yes, it would be sad and lost for those around him, but for him, it would truly be a celebration. And I think those words can ring true for us today as we reflect on who Erwin was to us. Because for so many of us, what's so difficult about trying to muster up the gears to celebrate is that we're just feeling the loss. We're just feeling the loss, I know personally, of a good friend, of a confidant, of a consultant, of someone who shared passion, not just for God, but for family and for church. And, you know, so many things about our get-togethers that I'll miss. I'll feel that loss. And I know many of you will feel that loss far more than I ever. But if we can shift our perspective from our loss of Erwin to what Erwin gains in Christ for all eternity, moment by moment, forever, maybe, just maybe, we can feel a bit of that celebratory spirit today. Now, to be clear, and I appreciated the guys going down this road, Erwin Wall wasn't perfect. I knew that as well as you guys did, and I once heard a pastor say, I'll never lie at funerals. I love that. Thought I'm not going to be that either. And certainly in my conversations with Erwin, I experienced much of his, call it stubbornness, much of his closed-mindedness. Frankly, I think that's what made us friends, is that he could endure mine as well. And I wasn't the kind of person who would crumbled like a house of cards every time he expressed a contrary opinion. I would push back and allow him to push back. And there was a mutual respect for each other, even though we disagreed passionately on many things. We didn't always see eye to eye, and I would see certain features of Erwin that I'm sure you as a family or as friends or even as employees, you sometimes endured more than you were endeared to. That's not the point today. The point isn't that Erwin gets to enjoy this life of Jesus for all eternity because he was good enough. That's not the way it works. The point is that he gets to enjoy this life of Jesus for all eternity because exclusively of what Jesus did, because of his sinless life, because of his sacrificial death, because of his miraculous resurrection. It's not by our own goodness or achieving some certain moral standard that we get to enjoy the promises of eternity with Jesus. It's only through the saving work of him. And I know confidently, as you guys mentioned, that even in his dying days, that faith in Jesus and in his person and in his work was strong. Now, every time I would visit him at the hospital or at hospice, the conversation would immediately deflect away from him and into me and what was going on in my world and how my kids were doing. I'm thinking, what do you care about this right now for? There are more important things for us to talk about. But the Jesus in him cared about others in that way and affected me deeply. Now, I saw the same, Doug, when you showed up from Africa. Doug had really just gotten there, brought his two older daughters, and as your daughters climbed up onto Papa Bear, remember the conversation immediately emerged into what was happening in Burundi and all the building projects and what was going on and the budgets and when the completion dates would be. He was way more interested in that than navel-gazing about him, about himself. What probably struck me the most was that every time we would pray together, you know, Erwin would say, will you pray for me? Yeah, sure, Erwin, hold hands, we pray together, and he'd start praying. He never let you pray first. I'm thinking, this guy is in hospice on his dying bed, and he wants to pray for me. He wants to give the best of Jesus to me, because even though faced with the reality of a terminal illness, his faith didn't waver. Certainly, he had lots of questions, lots of conversations, but his faith didn't waver. And I know he would want me to say today for all of you that he wishes that for you as well. That you would know not a life of achieving a certain amount of goodness so God will love you enough, but a life that would appreciate what Jesus has done, that would receive that gift in faith. He would want to encourage all of us today, especially with the example of his life, of just how quickly it can end and the brevity of life's breaths, so that we would reflect on who the person of Jesus can be for us, so that we could live in a way that we could say for us to live as Christ too. For those of us around the room today who've made that choice, he would want to encourage and challenge you to live these moments where God has given you breath with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength, to invest your time, talents, and treasures deeply and passionately into the purposes of God, to live out the days that God has given you with what the Apostle Paul refers to as that fruitful labor. But to know that to live is Christ, and to die is gain, because then you get to experience the reality of Jesus forever. I hope that we would live out that challenge today, because it's only as we live in that increasingly Christ-centered way that we can start to develop the kind of perspective that can actually see a moment like this as a celebration. Because it's only when we begin to live in that Christ-centered way that we can move the attention away from ourselves and the orbit of our own lives and begin to move our attention on Jesus and his leadership and his work in the world. That's the perspective that Erwin had, and the perspective that I hope we all can get to in these moments today. Because it's only at the time when we can shift our focus from the Erwin we've lost to the Jesus he's gained, that this time together can truly, sincerely be a celebration. Let's pray together. God in heaven, we thank you for the sacredness of these moments. We thank you for all of the family and friends who've gathered to provide support and to celebrate the life of Erwin. God, we're real clear today that all we celebrate is your life in him, your life through him, and the degree to which we could taste and experience that life through his life. Thank you for his years of fruitful labor. Thank you that we got to enjoy that, to be the beneficiaries of that. And God, you know our hearts even now, and you know the collective sense of loss that we feel. But I pray that you would get us to the place where we could see life the way Erwin saw it, to pursue Christ-centeredness, to pursue passionately cultivating our relationship with Jesus, to give us the hunger to experience you face-to-face, to experience you for all eternity. And God, when we get to that place, help us to realize that for Erwin, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. And to shift in our hearts from our loss of him to his gain of you, so that we can celebrate together as family and friends your goodness and faithfulness in and through his life. Help us to carry on his legacy, which is your legacy, to live for you and share your love and goodness across the globe, letting other people embrace the wonder of what a life with you can offer. We pray all these things with thanksgiving and in the name of Jesus. Amen.
I believe in the resurrection, and he will rise. Thank you, God, for allowing our past to be impacted by the life of Erwin Waller, for his story rooted in your story, for his commitment to the name of Jesus. May his legacy to make Jesus central in his life become our story, our passion, letting Jesus become the master of our lives. Go with us now, especially with Karen and her children and grandchildren. Enable them to be touched by your presence and encouraged by those who come around and love them and encourage them. Allow us all to stand firm in your promises and lead us by your Spirit. Keep us, protect us, make your face to shine upon us, and be gracious to us, and grant us your peace. And all God's people say, amen. So family will exit first, and then feel free to follow behind. Thank you.
Amen.